This lecture series will provide our staff and students with a unique opportunity to come face to face with, to learn from, and to ask questions of some of the world.
Foundation.net and www.local.sp. The latter one is the website of the official local foundation. Well, as far as I can recall from what I have read, Mr. Tao was from Brooklyn, New York, and he is
waterways and oceans, ravaged lands, erosion, a common experience or common knowledge. Even the most esoteric quest, which may not be as broadly appreciated or sensed, such as the depletion of the ozone layer and the accumulation of hothouse gases, have been brought to our attention. At which point does the damage become irreversible? How great an insult can the Earth take and still bounce back? Have we passed the point of no return with some of these issues? Possibly, probably not. It would be prudent, nevertheless, to take immediate steps to minimize the effects of the various threats. This requires no less than world cooperation among societies as well as their governments. Can this be achieved? There is another aspect of a proper environment that is important to consider, namely quality of life. This means various things to various people. But it may be broadly described as an aspect of life that goes beyond the minimal requirements of subsistence, shelter, and basic health needs. For many of us, quality of life involves artistic contemplation. This is not to be found readily in congested cities and congested living conditions brought on by high density population. High density population impacts profoundly on the environment and all aspects of the quality of life. It is difficult to imagine an environmental problem that would not be improved by a decrease in population and made worse by an increase in population. Since the current trend is manifested by an explosion of population in many parts of the world, it is clear that this factor in environmental problems demands immediate attention. The exceedingly high temperatures experienced in Europe this past summer may well have been a manifestation of global warming. If so, we have a clear example of one of the many serious consequences of ignoring the advice forthcoming from scientific and other technical groups. Nature's storehouse. There are many reasons for not destroying huge ecological areas such as rainforests. A main one is that such areas are vast biological storehouses of substances having important potential to benefit humans. This derives from the fact that living organisms, including both flora and fauna, develop chemical mechanisms that protect them from hostile environments, predators, infectious agents, and disease. Such problems have been solved in nature in a great variety of ways, most of which are yet to be discovered. The compounds involved can possibly serve humanity in many ways, as antibiotics, insecticides, herbicides, fungicides, preservatives, drugs such as anti-cancer agents and antimalarials, hard drugs, and many other types of physiologically active substances. Destruction of ecological systems destroys the opportunity to learn their sacred secrets forever. Economics and war. The Earth is finite, and the number of people whom the Earth can support is finite, under the best of circumstances. As a consequence, people have developed the concepts of a sustainable economy and a sustainable Earth. Rarely is the expression sustainable economy heard. The term economic growth predominates. Certainly, activities can replace other ones can grow, and to an extent, new activities can grow. Growth can also be associated with a rising of the average quality of life in the world. There are limits, however, and the limits arise from limits on on natural resources, limits on need and demand, limits generated by environmental considerations, and constraints on the total population. The latter statement provides a clear indication that future economic policy must be in harmony with the finiteness of resources and population and the requirements of a wholesome environment. Economic competition is often enhanced by limited resources for markets. In the extreme case, it leads to warfare. A major component of many wars has been economic competition. There have been, of course, additional issues, but it seems fair to say that economic motivation has predominated. Economic competition should not be expected to cease when warfare ceases. The experience of the post-World War II period, for example, is testimony to the fact that its underlying aspects of economic competition never disappeared, but simply has taken on another form. If and when the major players in industrialized states decide to confront economic reality by supporting and developing their humane and industrial capacities consistent with the broad concepts of sustainability and a large measure of self-sufficiency, they may be able to save their countries and future generations from severe economic hardship, if not destruction. There's not much to say about war per se. It's enormously destructive. It dehumanizes and brutalizes survivors, damages the environment, wastes resources, and may leave legacies of great potential harm to future generations. Nevertheless, warfare has been all too common a phenomenon in this past century. Societies must find other ways that are non-violent to deal with their economic stresses and other perceived inequalities. Certainly, pouring arms into those societies that are most likely to use them offensively does not help matters. The large and apparently irresistible profit motive in the selling of arms makes control very difficult. The economic gain may be short-range, but the harm can be major and long-lasting. There's not likely to be a net gain for any society in the long run. There are other circumstances in which perceived short-term economic gains motivate inappropriate behavior and result in net economic loss and harm to society. Industrial pollution is an example. Pollution often occurs because industry makes short-range economic decisions, or because appropriate legal regulations are not in place or are not enforced. I've made a point of this to emphasize that economic and environmental problems require clear thought on the part of all concerned. The problems that threaten the world involve everyone. Solutions to the problems may require expert help, but the implementation of the solutions involves us all. Societies and governments must be strongly involved and come together. Gainful employment in the age of automation. I recall reading an article several years ago that characterized our present economic dilemma, namely that a new revolution is taking place in manufacturing without being accompanied by a subsequent reduction in the workload. A main generator of this revolution is automation, with its accompanying efficiency. The author asserted that this is the first time a major manufacturing advance in efficiency was not followed by a reduction in the workload. The consequence of this circumstance is that advanced societies are becoming remarkably incapable of providing meaningful employment for a large fraction of its citizenry. Expanding populations can certainly add to the problem. In the present economic climate, in many developed countries, the industrial response Manufacturers must also be prepared to anticipate rather than simply respond to dwindling supplies of raw materials and rapidly changing markets. It would be most appropriate for societies to analyze the social and economic implications of the rapidly developing technologies, changing markets in the world economy, and other powerful forces that affect the quality of life in their communities. The problems are not insolvable. It would seem that successful societies would need to have a sustainable plan in which all the population would have the opportunity to make a contribution and therefore earn enough compensation to enjoy what most people would recognize as a decent standard of living. Can this be achieved in the atmosphere of competition that has characterized the industrial revolution up to this time? Is it possible to achieve sustainable economies and decent living standards without inhibiting the various aspects of individual initiative and creativity? There are a myriad of questions that societies may consider. The world, however, cannot possibly benefit from continued procrastination in facing these issues or wait for the results of endless debate and deliberation. Too much debate and little testing is as bad for societies as it is for science. What would need to be done, were governments willing, would be to take a careful look at resources, human and otherwise, set goals on the basis of high and presumably workable ideals, and implement them. There would be the need for flexibility so that, learning from experience, corrections could be made in a stepwise process. This would require governments to be composed of people or advised by people of the highest intelligence and personal standards, and whose greatest satisfaction would derive from the good results that they could achieve. This is not as difficult to secure as it may seem. There are many such people. The important step is for governments to be open to accepting well-motivated, well-thought-out plans and make difficult, selfless decisions for the good of society, unencumbered by parochial considerations. A view of the history of the 20th century suggests that the world is more than ready, but ill-prepared for such high-minded developments. That certainly seems to be broadly true. Nevertheless, there are a few countries that have renounced war and appear to have pursued for long periods steps towards a humane society. Ethics and education. It is important that young people be trained from an early age to question contemporary concepts and ideas that swirl around them. They should be taught how to think and draw rational conclusions. Together with this, the development of high standards should come from the home as well as the school. If they do not come from the home, they must come from the school. The learning of purely factual materials is, of course, indispensable, but education obtained at the absence of fine-tuned reasoning and an ethical sensitivity is probably a major contributor to current social ills. Valuable leadership qualities are the ability to apply sound intellectuality to problems and to use the results in an ethical fashion. It is to be expected that an educational system that emphasizes such qualities in general would raise the standards and the quality of life for society as a whole. In addition to learning how to think, a very worthwhile feature of an educational system is for it to be broadly based. Perhaps we may hope that in the future, training in graduate institutions will be prerequisite to appointment to high political office, and that the entering students will be among the finest graduates of an education. This appears to be a subject that merits careful consideration, since it seems to be vital for the achievement of more humane and ethical societies in the future. In addition to building character, it is important to teach young people to have inquiring minds and well-ordered priorities. They must learn to think, gather information, and draw rational conclusions based on the information. Considering the threats to future existence that is self-defeating to persist in maintaining many current societal priorities and values, there needs to be, of course, flexibility and respect for a variety of opinions. But when ethical standards, for example, are quite low, it should be possible to decide on which standards should be raised and in what way. We make laws to try to correct or prevent unacceptable behavior. It is much better when people's ethics, humane principles, and self-respect make the laws unnecessary or at least seldom needed. Indispensables. Population control is an indispensable. I am in agreement with many others who have indicated that unless population is brought under control, it will not be possible to enhance the human condition on a broad scale. Any progress will be eliminated by the huge numbers of people who must be supported if the unbridled increase in overall population persists. Population control must be achieved. The second indispensable is sustainability. The control of sustainability must be brought into the handling of environmental problems. Activities that degrade the environment can no longer be tolerated. Renewable energy sources, for example, must replace the burning of fossil fuels. Economic decisions impact greatly on the sustainability of the environment, and in fact on the viability and sustainability of the economy. It was pointed out in a talk that I heard some time ago that the inhabitants of Easter Island, located off the west coast of South America, used up all the resources of the island to the extent that they did not have enough food to subsist and did not have enough wood to build boats on which to escape from the island. Proper human behavior is an indispensable. The amount of animosity of various groups toward their neighbors in many areas of the world is a serious impediment to progress. The ease with which seemingly cultured society can be transformed to behave in a barbaric fashion is another sad lesson of the 20th century. Such threats of unbridled hostility and violence must be curtailed in a proper environment for peace and stability to be achieved. Barriers. The various barriers that can interfere with the broad attainment of a quality existence. The problems that need to be overcome are formidable. They are manifold and extensive. Great leadership in the world is required to overcome societal indolence, selfish motives, lack of character, perverse priorities and values, widespread unwholesome lifestyles, lack of cooperativity, extreme poverty, educational limitations, violence, and the lack of suitable mechanisms to settle disputes peaceably. Exploitation of the earth and of the people and a population explosion that's out of control. Societies whose survival is marginal cannot readily give much attention to the issues that are raised in this presentation. It is very difficult for societies or individuals on the edge of survival to change the patterns of their lives. Many marginal societies are overpopulated, under severe economic pressures, and have low levels of health care. Concluding question. We live in a world in which there dedicate. Thanks its harshness. Preserve the earth and generate a more equitable, humane future. The role of scientists and other technical people, at least in part, has been observed for many years. This concerns the many warnings that have been made publicly concerning such matters, for example, as global warming, pollution, loss of important information associated with the destruction of ecological areas such as rainforests, and the bad effects of flowing hydrocarbons on the ozone layers and in the atmosphere. Scientists and engineers can provide education and modern equipment to countries that could benefit.
Questions, comments?
will let Dean Mulasan to start first. You have the time, you wish, please.
My first comment is, since you were the Nobel Prize laureate in chemistry, actually we want to know a little bit how do you work, or what kind of work, or what kind of you are attend until you get the Nobel Prize.
Any secret in getting the Nobel Prize or any luck at all? What's it called?
It differs amongst individuals. Some people organize their lives and their research project with receiving the Nobel Prize first in their minds. I know many such people, and by and large, they never get the Nobel Prize. Disappointed every year. I never thought that in later life that I would receive the prize and that I would be elected to distinguished organization for various sorts, etc., etc. In my life, I was always interested in challenges. And early on, both my wife and I worked together on a lot of these challenges, because initially they were developments from our research work that was very similar. We had the same professor. If you want to do a good job in science, you must read the literature and keep yourself up to date in what is going on. And I remember the first big start in our research program after we received the PhD and after World War II. And it concerned the paper that was written by Peter Dubai, which opened up vistas of possibilities. And it was a challenge to redo what our thesis work comprised in a very much better fashion. We succeeded in doing that. And in the course of events, it turned out that people doing our work, which is something called gas electron diffraction, follow, you will find out the structure of gaseous molecules by doing electron diffraction instead of X-ray diffraction, for which the application is crystal. I learned by going to meetings which were held jointly by people doing gas electron diffraction and X-ray diffraction, that there were some really interesting problems in X-ray diffraction. And I don't have time to talk about it, but there were developments that we made in working on the gas diffraction that had profound applications along the line that an X-ray diffraction, you have something called the phase, I don't know what the phase is, but you don't get direct information about a phase when you do an experiment. And so all the minor books said that it's impossible to directly collect data for crystals and determine their structure. And I learned something from going to the meetings in the crystallography. Make a long story short, I was able to, I think it took about 5 seconds to look at the mathematics and see that it was possible to take the data from X-ray diffraction and work out crystal structure. Now, knowing that a solution exists doesn't always mean that you immediately know how to solve a problem. So that took quite a while, and it took longer than it would nowadays by all measures because of the difference in the possibility of doing computing. As essentially, it was built in the 40s. There were silly things like IBM had a multiplication device and it did one multiplication a minute. Give me an idea how many people get done with this. So, what I pointed out is that you have to be affected by the possibility of solving hard problems. And then you try to solve them. And I give a warning to my students and to people who ask me, get your satisfactions from what you do. Sometimes what you do is well recognized. But if you're going to spend your life waiting for that telephone call, you're not going to be happy in this world.
That answers your question. So you have to be affected to the possibility of solving the problem. And you have to enjoy your work in order to achieve whatever you intend to do. I believe there are some people in front who would like to ask questions. Shall we have one of the students here in the front to ask questions? In English or in Thai or in Tamil? We got a microphone for those in the front, please. Yeah, just any one of these. Got the gentleman in the yeah, the same one.
Open my mouth. What do you think of the role of the human to receive the world in peace? For every human and every religion and everywhere in the world. What do you think is it possible or is it take a long time to achieve this thing?
What is the role of what?
My wife.
Sorry, I'm just trying to say that in Thai again.
คนที่คิดว่าอันนั้นนั่นคือบทบาทของวิทยาศาสตร์และเทคโนโลยีในการสังหารโลกที่มีสันติสุขครับคิดว่าเป็นไปได้ไหมครับที่ว่าผู้คนทุกหมู่โลกสามารถที่จะร่วมมือกันแล้วก็สามารถทำให้โลกเนี่ยเป็นอยู่ในสภาพที่แท้จริงได้คิดว่าจะใช้เวลานานหรือเปล่า
The question is, you think how long it will take all those leaders who are in power to make this world a better place to live? From his perception, the world is now at peace. And he thinks only those who are in power can make it a better place for us to live. So how long will that take? Is it a mission impossible or just a dream? In your opinion, please.
I think it isn't as bad as it looks, in the sense that many of the larger and more influential countries allow people to vote. And I think that what has to happen is for the population to begin to do more thinking and understand what's going on so that they can vote for people who have higher standards and better understanding of the world than current politicians. They need to be replaced, and as I mentioned in one part of my talk, that they should be replaced with people who are of the highest integrity and people who are real good students and did graduate work. And somewhere along the line, if they weren't scientists, that they would at least be trained enough in science to understand its implications.
So we have to teach the politics students some science, animal science and things like that, maybe? For the next generation.
Well, the sooner the better.
Well, that's the answer to the second question. I think we still have some time for those.
Yes, it is most certainly true that science and technology has been used in many places to do the wrong thing, including its use in war. People who make war are people who are leaders of the countries that are involved, usually. And that's why, and I don't have any solution to this, but that's why I talk about training leaders who are of great ethical principles, and also teaching students well. In my own country, the standards of teaching have gone down very badly from the time I was a student. This has to change, and in the course of the home and the elementary school, teaching children at a young age how to behave and continuing that, the high standards of behavior. This is what needs to be done, and enough people are that things could change in the future. I would tell her what I think for myself, one has to try. And maybe along the lines, as things progress, you can learn things and it may not be so difficult as it is now. Because I say science and technology, but I'm also thinking about peace groups and all groups of people who want to do something about making this a better world.
So that answers your question. Well, perhaps one more question from the Reverend. Can I ask you correctly? Namaskar, who would know? The Reverend, please.
Well, I have two questions.
Okay, two questions, not one. Two short questions.
Maybe it's not short. One is for me and the other one is for the gentleman who sits near me here. The first one is that since you have discussed about the need to bring peace to the world, I want to ask you about as a scientist and as a human being, what's your opinion about the policy of the U.S. toward the world of science and technology in this case? Could you please give me a response to the first question?
Sure, I think that if you listen to my talk today, that you would know better than me even what I think of what's going on now. I don't have to answer that question. It's obvious that what's going on is totally unacceptable.
Okay, thank you. And the other question is my own question. I agree with you that you said about the interconnection of the world problems and the solution that you said that people should try to join hands to help each other. And I want to know that if there is a suggestion from you for us as individuals, you know, as one of the human beings who have to be with the friend that you have mentioned, do you have any suggestion for us as individuals?
As individuals, I don't have much of a suggestion because I think that people have to come together to have any influence on these problems.
So all individuals should work side by side to make this world a better place to live in. It's not anyone's responsibility, it's everyone's responsibility.
Everyone's responsibility.
But you know, told me that we don't have to worry about it right now because we will have like gas and oil for the 50 years from now. But what happened after this, you know, we have to think about the people, yeah, the younger generation after this. In your opinion, what would be a good source of energy for the future? You know, like 50 years from now, like solar cells, fuel cells, or hydrogen. And a lot of things, in your opinion, please. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. The answer is the United States, who are looking into a great variety of techniques for having alternative energy sources, and they're not doing too well. I think that in the context of knowing the groups that are working on this, there's no good solution that has come forth yet. They talk about fuel cells, but that's better than what's been going on. And plants, but it's not a solid problem.
The Dean of the Faculty of Science, Dean Munasa, please. A few words of, a word of thanks before presenting, Sumitian, sorry about that.
On behalf of the Faculty of Science at Tsinghua University, may I express our sincere thanks and appreciation to Professor Kaus for your excellent lecture. As the President mentioned at the outset, approaches today's special occasion can be considered to be very much part of those celebrations, though this has only been a very brief one. Perhaps the travel will bring them back to Tsinghua again. For the Faculty of Science, our heartfelt appreciation goes to Professor Kaus for a fascinating insight into the role which science technology can play in today's society and in the world at large. This has been a pleasure and a privilege for us to host today's event, the first in the series of Nobel Laureate Science Lectures. Thank you very much.
Where is the souvenir, please?
ขอสิ่งศักดิ์สิทธิ์ทั้งหลายจงคุ้มครองปกปักรักษา านทั้งหลายนะครับที่อยู่ในที่นี้นะครับจงประสบแต่ความสุขความเจริญที่มาก้าวขึ้นเจริญก้าวหน้าในหน้าที่การงานที่ยิ่งขึ้นไปคิดสิ่งใดในสิ่งที่ถูกที่ควรขอเพื่อสมและความมุ่งมั่นปรารถนา